encounters when previously unquestioned conventions are interrogated. Our first speaker is Sarah Wajid, senior manager of public programs at Royal Museums Greenwich. And she will speak, her presentation is titled The Uses and Abuses of Contemporary Art by British Non-Art Museums. Thank you.
Hello everybody, good to see you here, nice to meet you. I realised listening to the other speakers earlier that I made quite a lot of assumptions actually in my talk, and I realised I was being a bit parochial and provincial and that I'd written it as if I was talking to a bunch of Londoners. So just before I get started, it would be really good sense check for me if I could just get a sense of who in here has heard of Yinka Shonibar, and that's not a thing to shame you if you haven't. Excellent, okay, not everybody. So I was just in London world and thinking everybody basically lives in Greenwich and everybody knows everything about this artist's work. So I'll just sort of riff a little bit when it comes to talking more about him and expand a little bit on him. So just apologies for that assumption. Anyway, my name is Sarah and I've been quietly engaged in decolonizing museums and the heritage sector for more than a decade. Is this too loud? Am I shouting? No. Right. I currently have sort of one foot at the National Maritime Museum and my other foot at another museum in Birmingham, which is the second city in the UK, if you want. And I've been at the National Maritime Museum for the last 6 years in the learning department. And the thing that I'm doing at Birmingham Museums and Art Gallery is quite an unusual thing in itself, so I'll just take a moment to explain that. I'm a sort of state-sponsored museum activist, and this is a very odd thing to be, really, but I sort of, due to having been a bit of a kind of busybody provocateur generally within the museum sector over the last whatever, however many years, I've ended up on this sort of program, which is something that the Arts Council, the big funder in the UK, is doing to try and get more diversity amongst museum leaders. And by diversity, they mean what we call, you know, protected characteristics. In this program's case, it's particularly about getting more Black, Asian, minority ethnic people to become leaders of museums. So it basically means that there are about 25 people around the country called change makers who are going on this program for a couple of years, and we just sort of zoom off to another organization and announce ourselves pompously as change makers and say we're here to change and we've got some money from the Arts Council near and like get ready and do some changing. So I'm sort of a change maker, but I'm not that radical because I've kept my permanent job in case the old change thing doesn't work out. So I might go back, sort of slink backwards with my tail between my legs back to colonial Greenwich if the whole change making turns out to be a bit dicier than I thought. Anyway, so that's kind of me professionally, and I'm primarily a practitioner, and by that I mean I'm sort of a decolonizing foot soldier, you know, rather than a theorist or an art historian or an anthropologist. But I'm going to talk about art, and I'm not trained at all. I'm not an art historian. That's not my bag. I used to be a journalist before I was in museums, and now that I have been in museums, I'm kind of a bit happier with objects and social history. I'm actually a bit of an art refusenik, and I've accepted an invitation to fly, you know, quite far away from home to come and talk to people who do know about art. So that has given me some anxiety. So I just ask for your sort of indulgences for any art history gaffes I'm about to make. I'm drawing heavily because of that on discussions I've had with colleagues about this issue, particularly with our art curator at the National Maritime Museum, Melanie Vandenbroek, and on the research paper written by a woman called Helen Hilliard about the contemporary art program at the National Maritime Museum for the last, that ran for 10 years. So that's basically, I'm not plagiarizing them, I've just said that I'm leaning very heavily on them. So that's okay. Quick word of explanation, when I talk about the National Maritime Museum,
that's kind of interchangeable with the Royal Museums Greenwich, which is the group or the brand for a whole bunch of museums in Greenwich. And the National Maritime Museum is one, the Cutty Sark, the boat, is another, the Royal Observatory is another, and the Queen's House is another, and together they make up the Royal Museums Greenwich. But I'm pretty interested in the National Maritime Museum, and that's really my focus. So if I start slipping into saying Royal Museums Greenwich, and you think I'm talking about a whole other place, it's not that, they just sort of slide into each other a bit. So, bit of background, first of all. The Maritime Museum was founded in 1937 to preserve the nation's maritime heritage relating to the Royal Navy, the Merchant Navy, and the fishing fleet. It inherited the Greenwich Hospital collection, which is a large, significant collection of maritime art. With the acquisition of the observatory in the 1960s, the museum expanded its scientific collections. Today, the museum holds about 2.5 million objects, important collections of maritime art, cartography, manuscripts, ship models, plans, scientific and navigational instruments, timekeeping, and astronomy. The remit, as it says in the mission statement, is to illustrate for everyone the importance of sea, ships, time, and the stars, and their relationship with people. The core subject areas, one of the core subject areas which we return to repeatedly through almost every area of the collections, is the history of the British Empire, especially in the 18th and 19th century. The British Empire was a seaborne enterprise, after all, built on the power of the Royal Navy and maritime commerce. The painting collection depicts, and in many cases glorifies, the empire. The manuscript collection documents the rise and fall of empire and the lives of those who built it. Astronomy and navigational instrument collections show the technological developments in seafaring which made the empire possible. Crucially, the museum itself is a product of empire, its foundation, a consequence of imperial sensibilities, a significant portion of its collection acquired by imperial agents. In many ways, the Maritime Museum is kind of the British Museum about Britain. It's the closest thing that in Britain, I'd say, to a British museum, that and the Imperial War Museum. If you know, people come to the UK and they say, oh, but the British Museum's everybody else's stuff. Where's your stuff? Where's your national museum? The National Maritime Museum's probably got as good a case as any national to say, this is here, this is the story of Britain's relationship with the world. And as such, empire is very, very close to the surface of all of those stories. But it's a very complicated, ambiguous kind of museum culture because of that. There's a lot of ambivalence about having collections that relate so strongly to empire, because obviously there's a kind of moral duty and a relationship with those collections, which it doesn't say on the tin. It doesn't say this is the Commonwealth Museum. And the people who work there have a very ambivalent relationship with that sense of empire. If you visited the museum when it first opened, you would have encountered only artworks, actually. You would have been within your rights to think that you were an art museum. But today it's broadly understood as a non-art museum, a social history museum with a fine art collection. And though I've been working at the National Maritime Museum for 6 years and engaged in many interventions and practices that could well be described as decolonizing, the first time that I used this term in conversation with my colleagues was in the meeting about this symposium. It's not a word that you hear in the corridors of actually most museums. It's not a word that you hear at the National Maritime Museum. And I'm particularly glad to have been invited to consider these questions now, as the museum is about to commission several new artworks for inclusion in permanent galleries relating to empire. So it was a really interesting excuse to sit down with the curators of art and the head of interpretation and say, I'm doing this talk. Are we decolonizing? Is that what we're up to? Because I am. Are you? I mean, are we institutionally? Let's have a think. And it's sort of very near the surface, as I say, of a lot of our conversations. A lot of those meetings are about empire, particularly about these new permanent galleries that I'll come and speak to in a minute. But the sort of theoretical business of decolonizing is just not the lingua franca of an organization like this. And nor is it really, I'd say, of any museum that I know inside the actual sort of nuts and bolts. So, having said that, the question of how best to decolonise a museum has been at the absolute epicentre of a £20 million redevelopment of the museum called the Endeavour Project. Over the last 15 years, contemporary arts played a key but much overlooked role in all of this. So it's been a great satisfaction to retrospectively read these various commissions, acquisitions and displays through the decolonising lens and to consider what the next move ought to be. So the museum's acquisition of Yunke Shonabal's Nelson's Ship in a Bottle in 2012 has acted as a catalyst for rethinking the position of contemporary art in Greenwich. And then the Queen's House, the sort of gallery house effectively, a former royal residence which was designed by Inigo Jones, has just had a massive refurbishment and a rehang, and that was the home of a lot of the contemporary art programme. So the contemporary art programme was happening, it became dormant, I'll talk about that more in a moment, it was quite sporadic and sort of unsustained, but it was definitely dormant for a couple of years. But now that we've got this huge Yunke Shonabal acquisition, which is really in a prominent place in the museum, and the Queen's House has reopened with a contemporary art strand in it. Contemporary art has been championed by the head of art, who's a very ambitious curator, who was at Tate for 12 years before that, and art is occupying suddenly a much more interesting place than it had been doing for many years. Historically, art at the museum for the last 30 years was pretty much treated as illustrative. It wasn't so much look at this amazing work, it was like look at the frigate in this, look at the admiral in this, you know, it was kind of pretty much illustrative, and that was sort of where art was. So although you've already heard plenty of sophisticated paradigms about what decolonizing is, just so we're clear, I'll say the definition that I'm going with, which is a formulation that was in the Decolonizing Museum, the 2015 themed issue of the International Online. I think it was Nav Hack who wrote this. Decolonizing means both resisting the reproduction of colonial taxonomies while simultaneously vindicating radical multiplicity. These are two forces drawing in different directions, understanding the situation museums are in, critically and openly, and identifying those museums that already indicate a different type of practice that overcomes or resists the colonial conditioning. The term decolonization itself can appear somewhat forced to describe these two movements, as it suggests the return to a pristine state before colonialism. Yet to name this double movement seems more adequate than the common post-colonial. And I suppose the key thing for me is that it goes beyond the sort of the soft policies that are quite common that we hear about, things like widening participation or generally making museums more representative or democratic. It's about structural and epistemological and intellectual dismantling of those sort of frameworks are, as I said, at the heart of many of museums, like the one I work at, the Maritime Museum. It's in the very intellectual infrastructure of the thing. It's in the catalogues, it's in the collections. It's not just about the surface of bolt-on learning programmes and those kind of things. That's very common good practice. That's sort of basically kind of, you know, liberal nice people just doing liberal nice things. And that can go on until we're blue in the face. Decolonising is something quite specific for me. So, show you a slide. Oh, something happened. Can you see? Okay. You can't. You probably shouldn't see a holding picture that says "there's no internet." I'm just going to have a look what you can see. Oh, okay. That's sort of okay. And then, can you see something else now? That was so smooth when we did it before. A little bit of comedy for you folks, keep you awake after the coffee break. Right, I'll just keep chatting on. So of those four permanent galleries I talked about, three of them specifically relate to the history of empire. These are permanent galleries, these are going to expand the museum by sort of about 40% of the floor space, so it's a massive project. One of them is called Pacific Encounters, one is called Polar Worlds, one, Tudor and Stuart. So you can see just from those names that Tudor and Stuart period of seafaring was basically beginnings of the slave trade, and polar worlds relates to lots of indigenous populations, Inuk, Inuit, and Pacific encounters is all about the Cook's voyages and Cook's and encounters with people in the Pacific. So in two of these galleries, the curators plan to include contemporary art. They can see that? Yeah, great. So you should be looking at a design for the Pacific World Gallery, Pacific Encounters Gallery. So that's basically broadly what it's going to look like. So in line with good practice, source communities are being closely consulted for the Pacific Encounters Gallery. It sounds obvious, probably, I don't know, probably you assume that all museums always talk to source communities when they're developing anything that's got anything to do with ethnographic collections. It's a revolution, in our neck of the woods. Talk to people about their stuff. We've only got 5 minutes left, how can that be? Okay, cracking on. So we're talking to source communities, and significant sections of each gallery are being co-curated with them. Nevertheless, many stubborn institutional iniquities remain in place. For example, roughly 26 members of staff working across those four galleries, only two of them are not white, one of them being me. Over the last year, I've been on the Pacific Gallery team, and we paid very close attention to an exhibition at Tate Britain called Artist and Empire, Facing Britain's Imperialist Past. We paid close attention to it for two reasons. One, it was very controversial. Two, it had a lot of our actual loans in it. So it had pictures by George Stubbs of the kangaroo and the dingo. It also had a portrait of Tahitian woman Poitiers. And those works are actually going to be in the Pacific Gallery. So we were very interested to see how audiences were reacting to this process, and particularly the use of contemporary art in that gallery, because it was basically very... It was a very hot topic. For some people, that was an example of kind of terrible old-fashioned practice that was pretty much kind of celebratory of empire and showed a complete lack of self-reflexivity. For other people, that exhibition was a terrible, lefty, hand-wringing, guilt-ridden, boring whinge fest of a sort of self-conscious exhibition, and it wasn't very much in the middle. And actually, that's how quite a lot of permanent galleries that relate to empire do seem to play out, I would say, in Britain. So it was particularly interesting to notice what they'd done with the contemporary art. And what they'd done, these were two art historians who had curated the show, was that they had used, in the last room, they'd used it as a sort of riposte and put a lot of contemporary artwork clustered together in that room. And the interesting thing about the nature of the work they chose was that basically Tate have a kind of, you know, a standard, quality, merit, whatever you want to call it, of work they would, they would underwrite and say, this is stuff that we want to put on show. They suspended that criteria for this show because they sort of said, no, we need stuff to illustrate things about empire. We need stuff that speaks back specifically to these other historical works of art. So we're just going to pick the stuff that we think fits that. Not necessarily the best stuff, stuff that we think serves our purpose in this exhibition as a thematic historical exhibition. And there was basically a bust up internally at Tate about that, because a lot of the other curators were, you're all over my patch, I hate what you're doing, I don't agree with your choices of artwork, and you haven't succeeded in decolonizing or doing whatever you think you are, and if that's how you felt about the work, you should have put it on the walls yourself in your own words instead of ciphering it through the mouth of these substandard artworks. So that was quite tense. So we watched that and we thought, right, we don't want any of that happening to us. So partly in response to gaps in the collection, which leave the non-Captain Cook voices woefully underrepresented, a new artwork will be commissioned for inclusion in the Pacific Encounters Gallery. I'll give you a quick quote from the open call for the brief. It, the artwork, will allow sensitivities around the history of European exploration of the Pacific to be tackled by a contemporary voice within the museum, and to give audiences a sense of a history told through multiple perspectives, generating an emotive response. The artist will have access to the museum collections and expertise in collaboration with gallery team. This section of the gallery is intended particularly to give voice to inhabitants of the Pacific today, to give visitors a sense of a vibrant, thriving, and global community with rich connections to the past. This should be a fundamental part of the artwork. I'm just gonna skip through these because it doesn't really matter. They're like some galleries. You get the idea. On one hand, the gallery team are striving for polyvocality and decolonizing approaches to a problematic collection, while being all too aware that the risk is the artwork that is designed to fill a gap is not such interesting, doesn't result in such interesting artwork, and also that if the interpretation of that artwork is too constraining, it will limit the meaning, as happened in Artist and Empire. There are Tate, as I said, there are Tate-endorsed standards of contemporary work that would be selected on the base of high artistic merit, but they suspended all of that. And recently, Francis Morris, the director of Tate Modern, referred to Artist and Empire as a curatorial error. You heard that here first, because I've got it out for a talk. The Pacific team are aware that the permanent gallery with ambitious predefined learning outcomes is not always the ideal context for creative experimentation, and the room to fail is really important for any artistic commission, and museums find that really problematic because we like everything to work out nice and tidy. We've got tight budgets and deadlines, and we just have learning outcomes and meanings, and then when you bring art into that, that's really difficult to control, and you can't put a learning outcome and a meaning on that, but then you want good art. So how do you kind of commission a bespoke piece of art that's going to serve your decolonizing agenda and still get some good work at the end of it? So that's basically the conundrum. So I'd like to reflect on this moment. I'm only just getting started here now. It sounds like I'm at the end of my time. So I'd like to reflect on this moment at NMM as a kind of case study and offer my personal reading of how the curatorial frameworks have evolved that shape the treatment of contemporary art at NMM in order to better understand its relationship to decolonial strategies. For this, we must go back in museum history to the Trade and Empire Gallery of the 90s. The following quote typifies the responses and reviews we received to the Trade and Empire Gallery. This is like some old fart wrote this in the paper about the gallery. Rather than being proud of what we achieved during the empire, the emphasis is on guilt and shame. The chance to celebrate maritime greatness is pushed aside. The museum should be giving a strongly positive sense of national identity. Chris, boring history teacher, 1999. Another person said, the politically correct view of the British Empire is presented in the new Trade and Empire Gallery with its apologetic emphasis on the discreditable is deplorable. Contempt and hatred would be inspired in the children of this country's ethnic minorities for whom this distortion seems to have been designed. Tom. Rubbish in the Daily Telegraph. So interestingly, these comments foreshadow the sort of responses that we saw in some ways to the to the Artist and Empire show 15 years later. So that's a very kind of consistent strain in certain type of audiences, certain types of, you know, museum audiences. And Artist and Empire is a charged show. So Tate need to get those bums on seats, people who are gonna pay those 15 quid, and that's Middle England. And you know, that those people who've got very high education levels, have very high awareness and sort of knowledge already of art history. But you're playing to that crowd, and then that's the kind of pushback that you're gonna bear in mind. And that response that we got to the Trade and Empire Gallery has really marked the National Maritime Museum's kind of culture. It's been very cautious since that pushback, because that led to a lot of ructions around that gallery. That gallery was then redeveloped in a different way, and the directive to the team who came after that gallery, who worked on the next version, which is called the Atlantic Worlds Gallery, the directive was quite literally, don't rock the boat. We'll be happy if nobody mentions this gallery. Just do something quiet that doesn't ruffle feathers in either direction. And so, how much time have I got? What is that? Out of time. All right, out of time. I take 30 seconds to sort of mention Yinkish Onabari. I don't know, you want to hear about him? Show you a picture. That's not him. There's wind. There's ship in a bottle. Can you give me two more? Yeah. Okay. One more. Okay. You're harsh. Skipping this. This was much slower before. Okay, so basically there was New Visions, which is a contemporary art program, and it had some really flash curators working on it, and we had really flash artists, but there wasn't much institutional buy-in, so it wasn't embedded. And what that meant was that contemporary art was in a very fragile position within the organisation generally. It's not a big priority at a maritime museum, is it, contemporary art? It's not what the audiences are coming for, it's not what the director got the job to shine in. And so, although we had these like shiny people like Lisa Lefebvre, who's huge, like huge kind of contemporary art curator, and some very big names, and some of those artists were very interested in decolonial themes, like Jeremy Miller, whose work Given was about recreating an anthropological trip to Papua New Guinea, and those works hung in a room next to pictures, paintings from Cook's voyage. So you can see that there's a thread of like work that's interested in, you know, decolonizing the museum that was part of that program that ran for 10 years. Anyway, it stopped very abruptly with the change of director, so nobody really evaluated it or knew whether it worked or whether, but we know that it didn't go over hugely well with audiences, in that we didn't get big numbers and things like that. We also, what didn't happen really crucially with the contemporary art program was that there wasn't that thing that people were talking about earlier about the epistemological challenge going on with the museum. There was no sense of learning as an organization how to work with artists. We work with designers and exhibition designers, and we tell them what to do and they get commissions. Working with artists is a completely different rhythm for the organization, and the good thing would have been for us to learn as an organization to become self-reflexive, to yield, to learn new practices, to be flight on our feet, to take risks. But none of that happened through that whole 10 years, because those artists just worked with that contemporary art curator who basically seemed to live in a box and wasn't allowed to talk to anybody else in the museum, and the artists didn't engage generally with the collections or anyone else in the museum. And then Yinka Shonabari, and we acquired this, this, you can see why we might want this at a maritime museum, and you can see why I might want to talk about this in the talk about decolonizing museum. Maybe you could ask me a question when the time is up and I could chat a bit more about it. But in short, the big conundrum for us about this piece of work, got it 4 years ago, it's the biggest ever acquisition the museum's made of contemporary art, and it's physically the biggest ship in a bottle in the world. You can see from the sales, if you're familiar with his work, you'll know this is very, you know, there'll be people in this room who know a lot more about this than I do, but you can see that, you know, it's about trade, it's about empire, it's about this fabric is very complicated. It's not just African textile, there's lots of stuff going on in there. But mostly what people do with this is take selfies in front of it. And actually mostly what we frame it as a museum for the outside world, the interpretation we give is on our website. The main thing you can find out about this is what the best angle is to take a selfie under it. We literally, that's our marketing campaign, take a selfie with this. But he's a very sophisticated artist who is very interested in decolonizing the museum. And we had a whole massive contemporary art show that ran alongside the acquisition of this work. This was in many ways a really huge and significant acquisition for the museum, and a big step in decolonizing the frameworks, but we didn't use it like that. We haven't used it like that yet. And so what a lot of us members of staff wonder about Yinka Shonabari is, why not? Why don't we feel like that about it? Is it because he's actually artistically, it was quite a safe choice because he's a really well-known name. He's like, if you want, he's like the go-to, like one-man decolonizer for national museums now. It's like a bam, get a Yinka Shonabari, yeah, done, job done. Decolonized, rebranded, pish, bash, bosh. And I think there's a slight cynicism on the staff about that, although there's quite a lot of respect for him as an artist. I think quite a lot of people feel deep down like, oh, it was a bit of a lazy acquisition. It was just lazy. And so people haven't really championed it. And so how do we use it now that it's there?
Thank you. Sorry to cut out like that. Perhaps allow for one question. Anyone? Okay, I do have one. In terms of you talking about this room for fail for artists working in the museum in the intervention museological way. What about? I mean, since you, from the public program perspective, developing, you know, projecting, aiming for different ways, and also due to this kind of a problematic of how to take the best selfie, perspective with Yinka Shonabari, What other kind of remediations you think you guys are thinking about in the museum?
Well, I suppose the thing that's strongest, and the reason why I think actually it is a really significant and successful sort of intervention, is once a year there's the UNESCO designated International Slavery Remembrance Day on the 23rd of August, which marks an uprising in Haiti, which pretty much, you know, triggered the end of the slave trade. We mark that every year in the museum, quite a big deal. We have a procession. It ends at the riverside, which is just near the museum, which is where a lot of cargo ships that were involved in the slave trade left from that point on the river. So it's a very potent commemoration ceremony. It's a very potent site. And generally, it's black families who attend that day in large numbers. So you'll have hundreds of black families walking to the river from the museum, having had days of lectures. Now, since that artwork has been there, the relationship on that day between that program and that artwork is very different. So although people still might be taking selfies under the ship in the bottle, they're a very different type of selfie. So I suppose that's what I would say about those various levels of meaning that this artwork is available to us in the museum for. It's kind of up to us to step up to that artwork and kind of use it seriously and see the radical potential that it has in it and kind of meet it. Whereas if we just kind of quietly leave it there and say, like, this is basically a shiny landmark, and in some ways, the slightly odd thing that seems to have happened around it is, in some ways, it almost enables a silencing around issues of dismantling the museum, because it's there. It's this almost strange sort of like a small inoculation, because there's kind of no other signs. And lots of non-white audiences, when they first come to the museum, will say, this whole place gets my back up. This is your history, this is their history, not mine. Everything here is like cannons, and it's like green and pleasant land, and there's nothing reflecting me here. It's all very kind of uber tasteful in Greenwich. And having that little splash, like African textile, there's something kind of slightly, like slightly sticking plaster about it. Like, we've got that, so kind of like, don't need to talk about it. You know, and it can be strangely silencing. So that was the last paragraph of my talk that I was just going to give, regardless of the question. So that's it. Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Sarah.
Cheers.